know how these things work.
Oh, I don't trust easily. And it's hard to like people when you can't trust them.
But you do like me. And therefore you must trust me.
Indeed I do. But I would like you and trust you more if you liked and trusted fame a little less.
Well, that's my one great fault, I suppose, along with being indiscreet. But I don't really mean any harm. All my friends know that. If there's one thing in life they never have to doubt, it's my love for them. It's one of the great immutables. And you know that that applies to you more than most.
I suppose so. You do have a great talent for loving the unlovable.
Then my living has not been in vain. My father used to say, if you have one friend in your life on whom you can rely, that's more than most of us deserve.
And according to your father's dictum, we both have had more than we deserve.
As much as I loved him, I don't think my dear father was right, any more than you are. Wilde once said, one has a right to judge a man by the effect he has over his friends, in which case you will be judged fairly and fondly and with mercy, as I hope will I. So, sink or swim, let's just enjoy this strange voyage you're on. Will you take this woman, for better or worse?
I will.
In seasickness and in extremely poor health.
I will.
Those whom fame hath joined together, let no man put asunder.
Till death
us do part. Gilbert Harding had his wish for a quick and painless death granted. On November the 16th, 1960, he dropped dead near the BBC studios in Portland Place. He was 53. His body was taken to the studio's ground floor cafeteria. Even in death, he was still able to annoy diners.
Nancy Spain had her wish to die in harness granted. On March the 17th, 1964, she was on her way to the Grand National in a small plane on assignment for the News of the World. It crashed just outside Aintree Racecourse, killing everyone on board. She was 47. Johnny also died in the accident.
Just weeks before he died, Gilbert bared his soul on national television when he was interviewed by John Freeman on Face to Face. Viewers were shocked to see his fierce facade melt in a cascade of tears and candour. Radio Times later called it one of the greatest broadcast interviews of all time.
So many people wanted to attend my memorial mass in Westminster Cathedral that tickets had to be allocated. One of my friends wrote, I never knew an unhappier man, and I never knew a man who more effortlessly inspired love, loyalty, and friendship in others.
As Gilbert predicted, my death made headline news. The following day, the front page of every paper led with news of the crash. My editor said, even at the last, she gave us a story. But behind the headlines lay another story, which wasn't told at the time. How Nancy Spain's son, my son, only learned who his real mother was after he lost both of his mothers.
In 1963, my waxwork figure at Madame Tussauds was melted down and turned into one of Christine Keeler. The woman at the centre of the Perfumo sex and spy scandal that so obsessed the press and the public.
In 1977, the Sunday Times named me as one of the faces of the last 25 years. 10 years ahead of her time in being openly lesbian, she'd have brought to the women's movement a lot of fun and good sense.
David Jacobs, our solicitor, who was so fond of wearing full slap in court, handled our respective estates. Eventually, he went on to become the lawyer for the Beatles.
Before that, he represented Liberace when the flamboyant entertainer successfully sued the Daily Mirror for implying that he was gay.
There is nothing funnier than a blatant lie preferred to a blinding truth.
And when I die, don't bring back the truth.
Thank all the project partners, my wonderful cast here, my director Kenny Gardner, who isn't here today, but his glamorous assistant Carl Baldwin, who is. my script mentor Shelley Silas, the Marlborough Theatre, Torsten Ho, who made those lovely tracks for us, and Blueprint 22, who've been an enormous support and have been filming today's show. And of course, these things cost money. It's the first time in 35 years I've ever had funding. And trust me, it's not going to be another 35 years. But I would like to thank the initial funders, the Peggy Ramsey Foundation, and the Arts Council! This talk of champagne and whiskey means you're gagging for a drink. But before we go, we just sort of throw, if anyone's got any questions or, I don't know, anything you want to ask us, like where we've got a shirt or I don't know, anything. I iron those letters on myself. You know? So just if anybody's got anything yearning that they want to ask us or say or, I don't know, anything. Not a thing, they're all too shy.
just give them time.
What inspired you to write
Nancy? Well, that's interesting, somebody asked me that earlier, so I've got an answer rehearsed. I wrote Nancy Spain's biography in 1997, and last year it occurred to me that it was 50 years since she died. And I was thinking about updating the book and hopefully re-releasing it. And it occurred to me that there's been, to my knowledge, there's been at least one stage play about Gilbert Harding and a radio play, but there's never been one about the two of them, about Nancy and Gilbert, and they had this great friendship, and they were two very famous gay people who had these whopping great secrets that could have destroyed them overnight at that time. And the other thing was that in amongst all that, and it's amazing, when you set out to write a play, you don't always know what it is you're trying to say. But gradually, I thought, you never see, or you very rarely see, a play or a film or a TV thing or anything that actually portrays and celebrates the friendship between a gay man and a gay woman. You don't actually see it that often. You see stuff about gay men and straight women, but or gay men and gay men, but you don't often see that. And they did have this great friendship, and I thought, you know, it was very much at the back of my mind because I've got huge amounts of friendships with gay men and very deep ones and always have and always will. And I just thought, yeah, let's have a play about that, really. And I wanted it to be a play that not just, you know, talked about celebrity as well, how it's changed and how it hasn't, because there are some things that are exactly the same. And also, you know, if people, because now gay people can get married openly, doesn't mean there aren't still people getting married secretly, straight marriages to cover up their sexuality. It's still happening. So it's all of that. It's funny as you develop it, you don't always know what it is going to emerge, and that's what's been wonderful about the whole process. Is like I knew there were some things I wanted to write about, but more and more things came up, like the whole stuff about Tom Dryberg. That occurred to me between I think draft 2 and 3. Oh my God! And Dryberg worked with Nancy at the Express, so of course she would have known all that. So it was all, yeah, There was that.
But did they ever go on a voyage to Jamaica, or was that just a device?
No, that was actually true. It was actually true. I mean, a lot of it is founded in fact. They did go on the trip. They did get bombarded with telegrams. A lot of it is true. I mean, you know, some of it you just couldn't make up. Even the most warped mind couldn't make it up. You know, including mine. Well, you know.
Tell her about bending.
Oh yes. I had to do the cast because there was a speech about bending, which you all seem to enjoy very much. I didn't make that up. Gilbert actually said that in a book and got away with it. Anyone else? Can't really see you out there. Anybody else? I expect. Well, that was a good Q&A, wasn't it? I think we'll let you go now. Thank you ever so much for coming. I'll see you downstairs in the bar.
The kisses you gave me set my dreams afloat. I would sail the seven seas with you, even if you told me to go and paddle my own canoe. Sincerely, I love you so dearly, I'd follow you, darling, to any shore. You dream. Say that you'll be mine forevermore. You dreamboat, you lovable